So today we have with us a student from Delhi University who is an ML and AI problem solver, 3x Kaggle expert, HIIT and cycling enthusiast, and an avid non-fiction reader. Welcome to this show, Vyom. How are you?
Thank you. Thank you, Kunal. I'm doing amazing. What about you?
Good. So you're rocking it on LinkedIn, huh? You're posting a lot. Yeah, I know. You're recording videos. There's a lot of confidence coming through. So how did you manage to, get on to LinkedIn first and, post content and all of that?
Okay. So I'd say that it started off with, Gary Vaynerchuk from BRX.
Yes.
So this man went on, he kept on screaming for 2 years that LinkedIn is going to be the new hot stuff. You have to get onto it. And I never listened to him. Like, why should I do it? Then I was doing AI and ML for learning it for several months. Then one day I just felt I should just jump right into it and see what's happening. My first follower was my closest uncle. Mm-hmm. He is a corporate dude at Medtronic. He does his own corporate stuff. And he just kept on liking my posts. And I felt dissuaded. I'm like, no one is connecting with me.
Mm-hmm.
Then I started connecting with people.
Mm.
Random people I had no idea about. Mm. Told myself, you don't have to connect with people you know.
Correct.
You should go and explore that.
Yes.
Went there, mm-hmm. did some stuff. A couple of people from my school who had just graduated high school, they just got their board certificates.
Like,
how do you have 300 followers on
already?
I just followed other people.
Mm.
I just connected with them.
Right.
Maybe that gave me a little push. Went ahead and did my thing.
Absolutely. And back then when we started off with LinkedIn, it was very difficult to add another connection unless you have an email ID or something like that. But now it's become a lot easier.
Mm-hmm.
It's controlled and people are there is a sort of ethics to how people work on LinkedIn. And it's not like FB where people are just spamming stuff, but there is certain control to how things are happening. But it's getting very real and authentic, the way people share and show themselves. I mean, it's amazing. Speaking of AI and ML, right? You told you got introduced to AI and ML. So why AI and ML? How did you end up choosing this field?
See, I'm a liberal arts student. I have never coded a single line of code until March of 2020. I had no idea how to code in HTML, CSS, Python, nothing. But I just decided to, after my boards got postponed due to the coronavirus pandemic, I told myself, okay, I have time. What's the easiest entrepreneurial venture I can start? I'm like, there are a lot of stores in 15th sector market in Faridabad. Maybe you should go ahead and sell them your websites. I'm like, I should do that. But I was wrong there. Apparently, it takes way more than Python to get a website running.
Designing
I
skills.
Myself, yeah, designing skills. It drove me nuts. You have to do this whole UI thing. Can't I just do that with Python? No,
correct. Yeah.
So that means now I have to get into object-oriented programming. So I decided that I will go ahead and start learning data science. Just data science.
just data science. Yeah.
I have no idea what else I can do about this one. So I decided that I'll go ahead. I'll just, this random course by Andrew Ng, I'll go ahead and do my thing there. That's it.
That
course took a whole month.
Okay.
That led to a lot. It was a domino effect. That single course led to everything. That's a domino effect.
And so you come from the liberal arts background, right? And it's like coding is alien to you.
Right.
But then you're grasping concepts, concepts of Andrew Ng. It took me some time to understand some of its content. It's on Octave, right? Like the Andrew Ng's course is on Octave, and then you have to shift to Python.
Right.
How did you find that discipline to basically stick to the path and continue learning? Like, what did your day-to-day look like when you're trying to learn all of these concepts?
Imagine studying very hard for your board exams and then realizing, oh, wait. Out of the 5 papers I gave, 2 of them were 90s. I'll get above 90, that's for sure. And that isn't enough to get into a DU. You need to get 95 plus.
Correct.
Which means I, just for a backup, I had to give another examination called DU JAT to get into DU. And it's for separate courses. I was preparing for that and I got really bored. And I was losing purpose. It's like, what's the worst thing I can do while preparing for an entrance exam? Start coding. That'll help you.
Right.
That's literally what I did. I just can't live without a feeling of that I'm constantly working on something. I can't.
It's like being on the cliff for...
Constantly. Yeah, it's like if you aren't working, if you don't have a purpose, that straight away makes me push into inside of that cliff. That makes me... I won't use the word depressed because it has a lot of complications. I'd rather use it. I start to feel low.
Low.
I don't have a purpose.
Correct, correct. So, so basically, you felt that there's some void, and so obviously you want to do something to feel more productive or to not have a sense of no purpose at all. But there is something that you're doing that keeps you not getting low, and to continue doing things, right? So that's amazing. Like, again, I think so. It's a serendipity that you got into AI and ML, and then you picked up the skills. One thing led to another thing. You know, you're also preparing for all of these exams. Those are also hard topics. Even AI ML is, it's a hard topic again, right? Like, I know when I started doing machine learning, there's a lot you need to learn. First of all, Andrew Ng's course is on basically Octave. And then you need to, again, shift to Python to do all of your core stuff because Octave doesn't do all of that thing. So how did you transition from all of these things? Like, look, picking up the subject and then moving into Python.
I just told myself that if you don't like something, don't do it.
And so you started liking all of these things.
Yeah, I was like, okay, Octave is boring. I'm not going to code in Octave anymore. And one thing I did, I searched about Octave and I got reviews. I also talked to a senior. He is in SRM University, I guess, right now. No, he's in VIT. And I asked him, like, have you done this? He's like, yeah, I have done it. I'm like, any tips you want to give me about it? He was clear. We talked on Instagram. He's like, do not learn Octave. Octave is outdated. It won't help you get anywhere. If you want to code, code in Python.
Python, okay.
That was just an eye-opener. I realized ki, if I want to get something done, I should have the balls to skip on things and not fixate on them that are useless.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's a very wonderful insight you brought out, Vyoman. You know, some of the learners that come to me and they say, okay, Andrew Ng's course is an Octave. What should we do? You know, I'll say, like, look, it's a piece of code, right? You learn the concepts and the similar code that you can do it on another platform, right? But they get that stuck with that notion that, hey, I have to do this another thing, right? And just like you said, like, hey, if you've got to learn, you got to learn it, and you learn it and then move on, right? And so, when you made the transition from, let's say, Octave to Python, I'm sure Python had its own learning curve, right? Like the concepts that you learned in Octave needed to be, like, more or less not implemented in Python, but you got the idea and then you used different algorithms and used it, right? So for you, the transition was like, is it difficult to make the transition for anybody who's trying to learn and trying to figure what they should do in this situation?
I basically learned Python beforehand. In March, I learned Python from MIT's OpenCourseWare. The basic programming
basic,
course.
Basic
and they talked in theory and they didn't talk in code. They had some content. They had some exercises, basic exercises. I also searched up exercises to try for myself. I still have a lot of these exercises. A lot of them are named after Indian states for some weird reason. I do not understand why. I just look at them in my user folder. I'm like, why do you guys exist anymore? But they do. So, pehle Python. First, it was Python. Then eventually I moved on to Octave. Realized Octave doesn't mean crap. I have to go ahead and do my own thing. First principle thinking will be required here. Ask for advice, but do not fixate on it.
Absolutely. So, this is very important, guys. Like, if you're fixating on tools, you're not going to get anywhere, right? You have to evolve with times. And till today, right, you know, we had to evolve so many tools. Like, for example, when we started off 10, 11 years back, R was one of the tools that we were picking up. Python was just picking up. That time, we didn't even have pandas, right? And so we had to evolve from R to, you know, other tools, like SPSS, then Python came along, we moved to Python. Now R and Python are competing, right? And then tomorrow some other tools will come. And it's not only on that, like on Python, you have more packages coming up, which are like improving, you know, year by year, month by month. And those things, you need to be able to pick those up as soon as possible, right? And that's the only way forward. Absolutely. And you've got that nailed view on this part, because again, it's a tool agnostic field. It's basically to get the job done, whatever you need to do, just pick up the tool and just go get it done.
Yeah. Have a do or die mentality. You don't fixate on stuff.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. So Vyob, you told also that you've done several courses on Kaggle, right? We'll come to all of the Coursera MOOCs that you do there, but you've also done Kaggle courses. And what was your experience? And how did you, first of all, land on doing Kaggle courses, first of all?
Okay, so I did my whole thing with just what Coursera initially, because it was Andrew Ng.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually Andrew Ng. Even I don't know what exact pronunciation, I'll just call it Ng.
Andrew. Yeah, so Andrew Ng is just fine.
Andrew's course was cool. He's not a godfather. I think there are like more figures in AI who are more respected. But he started this democratization revolution where anyone could learn AI if they had the perseverance for it, if they had the consistency for it, anyone could do it.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, so I did the courses. I did all of my theory from Coursera, Andrew Ng's course. Then I eventually moved on to Kaggle and I didn't do anything for 2 months. I had no clue what to do. And then I found Kaggle has its own courses. And the first thing I looked, you guys give free certificates. I'm looking for free certificates. Because free certificates would mean that every recruiter would just fall in love with me immediately as soon as they see my free certificates. I was enormously wrong with that.
It comes with a price, but no fees.
You spent a lot of time trying to get certificates that no one cares about.
Right.
Literally,
right.
No one cares about your certificates. They care about your skill set and the projects you do, sure.
So right.
I started off with the first project that was there. It was Pandas. Then eventually, they had their own Python micro course, but I never took it because I already knew how to code in Python. So I'd say just get the basics of Python. Don't grab onto classes and super and basic, like very native init functions, because you won't be using them for a very long time.
Right. Absolutely.
Unless you're doing some really, really complicated stuff, like PyTorch requires you to understand the whole init concept. And I partly still don't understand it that well, but I'm able to use PyTorch. So my brain will call me dumb for a while, but sure, I'll learn it eventually.
So don't worry. Even we get that today also. The init thing. So you're not the only one, right?
Yeah. So it was Pandas. Then it was data visualization. Here was the time when I got introduced to Seaborn. Seaborn is a fantastic library and it is way better than Matplotlib. I don't understand why Matplotlib exists when Seaborn can do all the tricks in a better data visualizing format, but it just feels native. Like you're still going to code in native Python some way or the other. So Matplotlib is that when it comes to data visualizations.
Absolutely.
I still suck at data visualizations, so I just avoid it. I'm like, I'm not going to do it.
Again, there is a designing aspect to that and context aspect. Actually, you'll get there once you know data design thinking, like what the stakeholders want to see or what they want to get informed, right? It's that. And a lot of people feel overwhelmed, but you're doing the right thing right now. Like data visualization is for like more EDA purposes, but if you want to build dashboards and inform through it, you need a lot of business
APIs
context.
And dashboards, right?
Right. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So next, what did you do after that?
I skipped SQL. I skipped the SQL advanced SQL courses. Dive right into deep learning. I did the machine learning beginner, then intermediate. There was no advanced, so I didn't do it. then deep learning, and that was when I got familiarized with neural networks.
Absolutely. Okay.
I had a friend in the engineering section of our school. He's a junior, so I passed out of the school. He was still in 12th grade. He was doing engineering, of course, and he told me there's this channel, Deep Lizard, and they post videos using Keras. I'm like,
oh,
Keras sounds fun. Let me see it. They were using Jupyter. Like, what the hell is this?
Jupyter?
I had no idea what Jupyter was that time. I tried to use Kaggle's notebooks while trying to code in these courses, micro courses. I still had no idea how they work. I just start on shift plus enter, as they told me. Something happens when I do this.
Right.
First principle thinking takes time, but it helps you understand things way better.
You're speaking about first principle thinking, right? Can you elaborate that? What's first principle thinking?
First principle thinking is going into a field with no idea whatsoever of what you're doing. It's like trying to code a website. You have no idea what HTML is. You have no idea what CSS or JavaScript is. But you're going to sit on that website, code it piece by piece, line by line, till you fully understand what is happening in here. You're teaching yourself from scratch. It's like handing someone a book and telling them, this is the book about English grammar and English language.
Go figure it out.
Every line,
figure
it out. You might have the instructions in between the lines, but most of the time you're just trying to figure out what word comes where. It takes time. It's more time taking. And it eats up your brain, frustrates you, but it's the best.
Absolutely. I can totally relate to that. Even today, I get the kick of learning a new concept, figuring it out. And then, but data science is, again, very, very interesting in that way, because you get to jump from topic to topic and there is like never ending things to figure out and do and master, you know. So it never gets boring that way. So basically now you have all this information from, let's say, Coursera. You've done some courses, right? And then you've done Kaggle courses. And so now, like, all this learning is good, but like, when you need to apply it, right, there are things work differently there. So how did you do that part? Like, how did you work on that? Because it's, again, a very open field. It takes time to write a kernel, figure out things and do all of this. So how did you do that part where you put everything to practice?
How did I do that? I right now have 43 notebooks publicly available, 42 or 43 publicly available notebooks on my Kaggle. I gave myself the full freedom to try to imitate what others are doing. And if you fully copy them, always give them credit for their work, but try to understand what they're doing. Maybe watch a YouTube video. They're doing something. You've done all these Kaggle courses. They have taught you something. Now go ahead and put that work into, say you have a data set, start just by data engineering, post notebooks about it that, hey guys, I just did my first notebook. Get your hands dirty with data engineering using pandas, post that notebook right away. Don't sit on it. You should be keeping your notebooks private. If you feel confident enough about it, if you have worked, the community will respect and appreciate your work.
Absolutely.
But again, Kaggle, I feel Kaggle will saturate very soon, like very soon. It's on its point. It may be on its tipping point. Right now we have 20,000 active monthly kernel users. But the thing with it being, I know that Kaggle started off with saying that you need 5 upvotes to get a silver. Now it's at 20.
Right.
Audience is increasing. But that's certainly nothing. I just say, get your hands dirty, copy people's work on Kaggle, but do not copy paste it, type it line by line, try to understand what they did there and do it thrice. That's it. Now you know how to code.
Absolutely. And a lot of people don't get this view. Why do you think, like, do you have any experience where you're trying to explain a fellow, friend of yours that, hey, just go to Kaggle, look at people's work, copy, reuse, give them credit and then just post it. Like, what do you feel about those people? Like when they're not getting the simple fact, like you laid it down very easily and you know, everybody has to do this, but what do you think is going on in their mind when you're not listening and not doing this part?
Because they have heard the same thing in one way or the other everywhere. And now they just think that since everyone is saying I'm not going to do it, or since this is conventional wisdom, I'm not going to do it.
Right.
One of the major things I realized in 2020 was conventional wisdom works, but nobody's using it.
Correct.
And it's a gold mine out there. But since everybody knows about it, no one is going to do anything about it.
Yeah. If you put a price to it, you know, everybody is going to be willing to buy it. But if it's freely available there, I mean, nobody's going to touch it.
Yeah, nobody's going to touch it. It's like, okay, guys, I'm going to start my own course and I'm going to charge you like 1 lakh rupees. Personally, featuring you. This is actually a plug for myself. I might start one anytime soon now. So if you just hit me up on LinkedIn, I reply to every DM. I try to. And maybe 1 lakh rupees a month and I'll do this thing for you. I'll make you Kaggle 3x expert in less than a month. You'll have a job before we finish. And suddenly everybody is like, oh my God, he seems like a dude who knows everything since he has a price tag. They jump on board. They realize, oh no, they are in for my money.
It does. I'm a marketing guy. I know.
I have respect for marketing dudes. I'm not cool with advertising dudes. I'm not cool with advertising people for some reason.
But I see you do a fair bit of good writing yourself.
Yeah.
I mean, good copywriting. If you had to say, let's say if you did copywriting, you'll definitely do good.
Yeah.
Because some of your posts grabs attention, right? Like, hey, okay, wait a minute, what's he saying? And then you read and then you get, there's a subtle hint of comedy. There is some entertainment to it, right? So you can do marketing actually. I mean, if you continue writing like this.
I just told myself that, Vyom, you want to type. Okay, so there was a time when I really forced myself on LinkedIn to post every single day.
Mm-hmm.
I hated that 1 week because... Mm-hmm. I had to force my brain to think of something. You know, there is going to be something that's going to come out. Type it down. Just type it down somewhere. Just type it down.
Mm-hmm.
I quit. For 2 days, I didn't type anything. Then Thursday, I'm like, I just went to the market and this shopkeeper wasn't nice to me. So I'm going to cycle for another kilometer, go to this another shop that I just came from and buy my flowers from there. As well as I'm going to buy these birthday balloons from here too.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, wow, content on LinkedIn. I'm going to type it down. If he types down,
marketer at play.
That is content.
Yeah.
Content is like when it comes naturally, it's going to be good. If you're being authentic with yourself and the people, it's going to be good.
Surprisingly, all the authentic content works. I don't know how it works, but it does.
I don't know either.
Yeah.
I don't know either. People are like, okay, he's talking about the mother.
I know.
Why, dude?
And you know, I was basically talking to another friend of mine. He wrote a post about he receiving a letter back from APJ Abdul Kalam, right? Like he wrote to APJ Abdul Kalam. He just posted that, hey, small town guy, sending a letter to getting the response and you know, all of that thing, right? That got like a million views and so many likes and all of that thing, right? And it was a very authentic story, and it did inspire a lot of people. But I mean, that authenticity with a little bit of copywriting, like a small town boy from village getting a letter from AP, you see that small words, that marketing words, those gave the finishing touches to basically explode that article. And I mean, as you rightly said, you need to continuously do it to do it. Even I'm not consistent, guilty of not being consistent sometimes, but I use scheduler platforms. I use scheduling tools. You can use like Publer or something like that, which like you say 10 posts at one time and then you schedule it for 10 days at one time. And for 10 days, it's going to post on behalf of you while you can think of new ideas, right? And so that's another thinking that probably you can embed in yourself where you're thinking in bulk rather than.
Thank you. I'm awful with time management. With time management.
At that age, don't expect a lot much. So, I mean, you're learning enough. Yeah, that's more cool.
I'm like, it's like my brain constantly starts on screaming. You're in first year of your college. This is most of the time that you will have in your entire life, Vyom. Correct. If you don't use this right now, you'll regret it when you turn 30. So I'm trying to just do everything that I can possibly have fun with. I'm like, okay, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Mm-hmm. If it doesn't work, it's not my fault.
Mm-hmm.
And I genuinely don't care about if it doesn't work. I'll learn from it if I get a lesson. If mm-hmm. if it is just random statistics, no way I could think about it.
No. Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, you're doing way better than a lot of us did. I'm sitting at 30. I know I'm regretting a lot of stuff, but
I'm young. Okay. When I say 30, I'm speaking from an 18-year-old's perspective. All right.
No. You're when speaking 30, perfectly right.
Right. When I turn 30, I'll feel like I'm young. I'm so young. Gary Vaynerchuk, you know how he keeps on saying that if you're 54 and you aren't doing anything because you feel you're too old, you're messed up.
Mm.
There's no age for trying, sure. I'll just look, when I'm 30, I'll just look at these 54-year-old boomers and I'll just say, hey, these guys can't do anything anymore.
Correct. And again, but at the 30 also, you know, that first principle thinking, that's the same mindset even I'm carrying today. Like I started pretty late, like maybe 25 or so on the first principle thinking, but then that hit off. Like one of the things that you said, like you're a nonfiction reader, like, and so, you know, I did not read a book till like 26 years of my life. And that year, like I said, right, like I wanted to, you told I'll sit down and do this no matter what for the next 30 days or something like that. That even I did the same thing. Like, okay, I'll read one book in 1 week for, let's say, 52 weeks this year, right? Let me do it. I couldn't read even 12 book. I mean, I couldn't read 12 books, right? I just read 10 books, but that was a start, right? Versus zero from 10. And still that instilled in me that first principle thinking. And then, okay, no matter what it is, just keep going and you'll figure something out. And I did, you know, and that's thinking that carries away. And you're like beginning young on this first principle thinking, which is great, I feel. Yeah. Speaking of books, so what sort of nonfiction books started you off?
Something that my generation would consider
Gyan.
And Gyan. So you're just doing it just so that you can flex on other people. I'm like, dude, no one even wants to talk to me about it.
Yeah.
Business books, mostly business books, then psychology.
Mm-hmm.
Because for some weird reason, when I was in 10th grade, I just told myself, if I know people's body language, then mm-hmm. I can manipulate them, then I'll be the most popular kid in the school. I was 10th grade. I couldn't help myself. There was a book named... tell me, you seen something?
What was the book name?
The book's name was The Definitive Book of Body Language by Alan and Barbara Pease. I still have that word on my name, even though I sometimes read books without knowing their author and the name of the book. I still read them anyway for some weird reason.
I know.
But, that was the book, and it started off this thing where I would start reading about sociology, Freud. I have like read like one Freud book that was during my board exams. I still regret it.
I know Freud is very heavy, but
Freud is crazy. Freud was nuts, but he's very entertaining though.
Yeah. So
Freud was fun, but that book just kicked off a whole start. Like series. 11th grade, it's just a series of me wanting to read more books.
Absolutely. And as long as you have this habit, it's going to work out. You know, if you want to follow, just try to follow Naval. You know, he's more or less going to inspire you a lot better in this field. The way you are taking things, right? Naval Ravikant, if you listen to his podcasts, micro podcast, but packed value of stuff on how to think and all of these principle thinking and all of that thing. And it's great. Even he's inspired me a lot. Now that you've basically done Kaggle, you've done the learning. Now you've also mastered creating a personal brand on LinkedIn. Now you're putting you put all of these things together, and now you have to put it into action, right? Like congratulations on, first of all, landing your internship. But how did you land that internship?
Actually, my internship ended at like 31st of December. I was done with my project before that.
Mm-hmm.
But he let me just play around with stuff and his server. So I was like, thanks. So I did my stuff there. So I'm right now in talks with another startup.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I'm allowed to say the name or not. I do not know. I should have asked them.
No, it's okay. No need to mention their name. It's just, just want to know the story of how you got there. That's all.
I just texted the co-founder. I'm like, hey, I worked on this thing in my last startup I worked with.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to use this thing in your startup? And the co-founder replied, she has 30,000 LinkedIn followers. I was like, she's not going to reply to you. Nothing worth trying. She did. We had a whole ass conversation about AI, NLP, using classifiers and reporting systems, all sorts of transformers and deep learning stuff. And I'm like, damn, this lady is fun. I had an interview yesterday. Yesterday, the day before yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
It went optimistic. Now let's see what happens. I have a pending call, so let's see what happens there. So you want to start with my first startup story?
Yeah. The first startup story also, because you know, a lot of people struggle there. The reason I want to ask this question is, people say, I've got the skill, I'm on LinkedIn, I put up a profile, now what? I'm not getting requests, right? But
yeah.
You told another important thing when you're speaking about LinkedIn, right? Hey, you went on LinkedIn, nobody's adding you, but then you started adding things, right? It's called reach out. It's a simple logic, right? Out. Like you have to reach out. You can't sit there and wait and let things happen to you. It's not like you're sending a resume and putting it on your portal and people is going to hire you because you have an awesome resume. No, it's not going to work like that. You have to reach out. You have to just call people.
Definitely. It's like me putting up in my LinkedIn. See, I don't look down upon anyone. Mm-hmm. I want to make that very clear, but people putting out on their LinkedIn bio saying, looking for opportunities, that's not going to happen magically. You have to look for it. You have to go ahead and push yourself out of this comfort zone.
Correct. Right.
So, it's like, you just have to try, go out there, try. In fact, the first internship that I got, it was by a cold call. It was literally by a cold call.
Mm-hmm.
How? The co-founder texted me saying, hey, we are doing seminars on this platform.
Mm-hmm.
I'll pay you this much. Do you want to do your own thing about, say, FastAI? FastAI is a library in Python. And it's based off on PyTorch. You would know that, obviously. So
Yep.
You could talk about that.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, money is good and I'm not earning. It's like a couple of $1,000 is more than zero.
Right.
It's always
more than zero.
Anything more than zero is money. Okay. Right. Obviously. So from there I was like, okay, sir, wait a minute. I want to ask you something. He's like, go ahead. Tell me, how can I help you? And he was like, I meant, how can I help? No. How can I help you? So what do you do? I do stuff with AI. I have been working with computer vision and machine learning along with some NLP.
Mm-hmm.
And so what are you looking for? And he's like, what do you need help for? And he's like, well, we have been working to form a seminar platform.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have these comments and we just want to highlight these offensive comments so that people know that this is offensive. Don't look at it.
Mm.
I have no idea what you're talking about. I have literally no clue how to make that happen. Uh-huh. But I can help you. I didn't see the part.
First principle thinking.
Yeah, I just told them that, sure, I can help you. He's like, I'm like, I am going to use NLP.
Mm.
I'm so glad he didn't ask what an NLP, because I wouldn't have been able to answer. I had no idea. I had no idea how to do that.
Okay.
Just jumped right into it. I didn't lie. I didn't lie at all. I just said, I'll use NLP. And I did use NLP.
Mm.
So went in. The project was for 4 weeks, but it got extended to 3 months because I was having fun, apparently. And just did my thing, wahan pe.
That's it. So basically, again,
random stranger.
Random. And these are the things only happening. Like, you're reaching out, like you're constantly reaching out. It's not like a one day thing. I reached out one day and then I sat down. Right. It's not like that. Like, you have to constantly do this thing. You never know when you'll get the stuff, but it's that consistency that keeps you alive and keeps you going, right? Absolutely. I mean, that's an inspiring story, Vyom. I'm sure a lot of this, the audience here is basically getting something from this. Okay, so one last questions I had on this. Now, in the internship, you've done so many things on like Kaggle and courses and all of that thing. What did you learn in the internship, right? Like, apart from these things that you're solving, like, what are the things that you picked up? Like, if you put three things that you learned from the internship that three changed your perspective. Okay, let's see how let's see how many.
I'm going to try to complete it under like 10 or 5. So I had no idea how to code in HTML, CSS. I started coding in HTML, CSS. I started web development because they wanted to test my model publicly using deploying it separately. I'm like, fine, I'll do it. I'll learn things. I also learned MongoDB. I had no idea what that was. I had to learn it. It is not awful, but it is not fun either. Other than that, I told you that I had no idea what was this thing with NLP. FastJ just makes things so easy to do. By just coding 7 lines, you have a model, right?
Yes.
I started coding using the Hugging Face library for transformers, so publicly available transformers. A little bit of PyTorch, but I relied on other libraries such as single transformers to develop my model. And I had no idea what was the thing with NLP. I learned it on there. Like, I searched for articles. I grasped those articles. I'd say that the best thing that happened to me was my superior was the co-founder of that company and was in fact the founder of that company. And he wouldn't take a no for an answer.
Nice.
He would keep pushing me. He'll be like, the one thing, okay, so the one time that I got a no, I finally got an acceptance for a no was he was pushing me to use a particular transformer that was just released a few days ago by Google. But I didn't have a bank account or a credit card at home which worked with Google Cloud services. So I was stuck. And they asked me for like having a GCP. Without it, I couldn't use it. And I was stuck in this whole dilemma of what do I do? Then I just asked him, can I wait until Hugging Face is another library, right? Which has all of these transformers in it. Let's just wait till they have it. And I was right. They eventually had it, but I never used that transformer though.
Nice.
So I would conclude this by saying he never took no for an answer. Just won't. Pushing me constantly. If you don't know how to do it, learn it. I won't take no for an answer. Never said it in a very authoritative manner. He just used like, you know, Ramanujan's story.
Ramanujan's, what's the story?
I have no idea. I don't remember. he said Ramanujan's story and he was like, I was like, I have no idea. So I think he was mentioning towards it. I think that Ramanujan was given a maths textbook. He didn't know maths, anything. Probably Ramanujan or some mathematician. He went abroad eventually, showed his papers and did his all things. I don't know if it was Ramanujan or some other scientist. But just kept giving me key figures who did it without any help, learning from first principle thinking. So it just got reinforced here.
Right.
Reinforced. I did nothing by learning everything.
Inspiring you. All this said, guys, what Vyom is pointing out is like a 4 weeks turned 3 months because he was enjoying it and he was having fun doing it. And so one thing led to another thing. And as you can see, Vyom has basically delved into multiple areas as need came by, right? Like, and obviously was fortunate enough to have a mentor who never took no for an answer. And those are some of the best mentors you could probably find. Truly inspiring, Vyom, and thank you for like sharing your journey and giving us all these bits of how you used to your personal brand on LinkedIn, how you used free certificates, which do not work, but putting all of that knowledge together and the first principle thinking is something that I'm going to take away from this entire thing, and it's going to stick with me, and I'm going to probably mention that a lot many places, and I'll tag you there.
Sure, definitely.
Give the credit to the person you heard it from. and thank you for coming and doing this on this show. It was valuable for the audience here.
Totally.